Wait a minute. Which part of the Quran that you read that you remember?
I'm trying to find a verse that says, love your enemies, and I can't find one.
And if you...
I've been right through it.
Okay.
And you see, the Quran can't hold a candle to Matthew 5 or 1 Corinthians 13. Do you know what they are? Answer me.
I'll bring up 1 Corinthians
36.
Okay.
What about Matthew 24:36? What's that?
I'm on about Matthew 5 and 1 Corinthians.
No, no, okay.
Don't change
you know.
The subject.
Did you mention 1 Corinthians? Okay, let's read 1 Corinthians. Yeah. In 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 24, wait a minute, verse 24, it says here, then the end will come when he hands over the kingdom to God. This he is Jesus Christ. Wait a minute, wait a minute. It's still about justice and injustice, about hell and heaven, about the last days. We're still talking about that. Well, this is about your Bible, so it's from God, right? You believe that, don't you?
I'm leaving it to God.
This book is from God, is it not to you?
I see through a glass darkly, I know in part.
Is the Bible from God?
I shall know, as also I am known.
Okay, that's fine. I'll read the Bible because you want to...
No, I want you to read the Quran.
No, I'll read the Quran in time.
He is embarrassed and ashamed
of the Quran. No, I'm not at all. I'll bring the Quran up next, don't worry. It says here,
Muhammad or Jesus?
Then the end will come.
Who is the greatest?
When he, Jesus, hands over the kingdom to God, the Father, after he has destroyed all dominion, authority and power. This is Jesus who destroys them. For he must reign until he has put all his enemies under his feet.
Why are you worried?
This is Jesus again, by the way. Wait a minute. It says here, the last enemy to be destroyed is death.
That's right.
Good. So that's the only bit he agrees with. For he has put everything under his feet. Who is that he? God. Now, when it says that everything has been put under him, it is clear that this does not include God himself. So when Jesus has put everything under his feet...
This man has got a problem.
I'm reading the Bible.
No.
How is that a problem?
It's trying to understand it by the textbook, by mathematics. You can't do that.
So I shouldn't read the Bible. Is that what you're saying?
Great is the mystery of godliness.
Should I not read the Bible to understand God? Is that what you're saying?
Great. The natural man receives not the things of the
Spirit. Let me finish the verse and then you can
just
give me a poetry.
You cannot understand.
I haven't finished the poetry. I haven't finished
the
verse.
Man.
Okay. I'll tell you what. You make me understand the Bible if I don't understand it. Fair enough? It says here, now when he says that everything has been put under him, it is clear that this does not include himself who put everything under Christ. When he does this, then the Son himself will be subject to him who put everything under him so that God may be all in all. When he says here, you said I don't understand it. You make me understand this verse. When he says here, when he does this, when he, Jesus, does this, then the Son, Jesus, himself will be subject to him who put everything under him so that God may be all.
I'll come back to my...
Explain that to me.
Just a minute. I'll come back to my original point, which you have dodged.
Which is?
Matthew 5 and 1 Corinthians 13.
Okay.
He has absolutely dodged it.
And what is the point you were trying to make with that?
Hey? I thought you knew the Bible.
No, I didn't say I knew all the Bible. I read it based on the verses, yes?
If you only,
when did I ever say I know all the Bible?
If you only love those who love you, what credit is that to you? If you're only kind to those who are kind to you, what is that out of the ordinary? There is nowhere in the Quran that says love your enemies.
Okay, so do you love your enemies?
We've been there before.
No, do you love your enemies?
Yes.
Okay, what do you do if your enemy comes and rapes, for example, one of your family members?
Why is it?
Do you love them?
Why is it with Muslims?
Oh, you don't like the word rape and murder and all. It happens.
Why not stealing
it
a
happens.
Cabbage? Why not stealing a cabbage?
Why?
Because, why are you always thinking
because
about
stealing
murder?
A cabbage is not as significant as rape and murder.
Why are Muslims always thinking about murder?
What would you do if someone murders your family?
Murders my family?
Do you love them?
They would go to the courts.
No, but would you love them?
Yes.
Oh, would you take them to court?
Yes.
Why would you take someone you love to the court?
So justice can be done.
Oh, so you don't believe in the love, the kind of love that you want to have with the enemy?
Truth and mercy are twin.
Ah, I see. So you want justice at the end?
Yes.
Thank you very much. So it's not just all love?
Yeah. Truth and
you see, you have just contradicted yourself. No. Earlier it was all love, love, love. And now all of a sudden he wants justice. You know why? Because his family is involved now.
I didn't say all love.
When his family is involved, he wants justice. You know what? Everybody wants justice.
I didn't say all love.
So how can you love your enemy if you're going to take them to court?
Because you've got a problem.
With what?
You can't love your enemies.
Why should I love an enemy who wants to kill my family?
Why is it always the worst scenario? The Muslims are always thinking about murder.
Because the example of the worst scenario is what makes sense in this in this context.
Stealing a cabbage?
Because, okay, I'll tell you what. Would you take someone to court for stealing a cabbage?
No.
Exactly my point. You see what I mean? The only one you want to take to the court is someone who has done a major crime or a major sin in your case.
Why is it always a major crime with you?
Because that is the one who goes to court.
You've got a problem.
You got a problem with cabbage?
You got a problem.
You got a problem with cabbage? You always think about cabbages, right?
Always think.
What's with cabbages and you?
Always somebody raping you.
Okay, anyway, I want to know, how would the Bible establish justice?
Matthew 5, 1 Corinthians 13.
Yeah. What about it?
The Quran can't hold a candle.
Look, the Quran is very clear. The Quran, in the Quran, Allah says, do not oppress people. And the oppressors are condemned by God. They are not loved by God. And there's a reason for that, because if you have oppressors like Hitler, oppressors like Hitler and like ISIS, you do not love them. Do you love Hitler and ISIS?
Just a minute. I believe not in a limited atonement. You can't have such a thing as a limited atonement.
What is a limited atonement?
Well, forgiving for a cabbage, but not anything else.
Okay, so when you say,
you can't have a limited
atonement. Are you saying people should just forgive murderers?
Forgive them. If they can, by the grace of God. By the power of God. It might not happen overnight. We found people in Ireland that have forgiven and forgotten.
But you know what you said earlier when I asked you the same question? You said because it was your family involved, you said you'll take them to court. Why the double standards?
What's wrong with that?
For the others, you say forgive them. When it comes to his own family, take them to the court.
I don't want to kill them. I'm not killing them.
I didn't ask you to kill them. You do not take law in your hand. So you take them to the court. Is that right?
What's wrong with that?
Nothing wrong with that. That's what you should do. That's what I'm telling you.
Good.
But you're saying just forgive them. If you forgive every murderer, every rapist, every criminal out there, you'll have the streets with chaos. There'll be chaos in the society.
Sinner, but not the sin.
It's not in the Bible. That's not a verse in the Bible. That's your opinion.
No, it isn't.
It is. So, is that a verse in the Bible?
Jesus loved the sinner.
Did he?
Is
Jesus going to not kill them? I just read the verse to you. He puts all his enemies under his feet.
Why are you insulting your prophet?
I'm not. This is your Bible, by the way. It is your Bible insulting, not me.
No.
You don't like that, do you, now? Look, if I read the Quran, yes, you will object to it. But this is your own Bible. And if you think that is insulting, then speak to the Bible writers.
What he can and what he can't.
Just like you said, I was insulting the prophet. And now you're saying, I'm not telling God. I'm reading to you what your God told you.
You have got a problem with Jesus.
What kind of problem do I have with Jesus?
You've got a problem with Jesus.
Go on, tell me what problem do I have with Jesus.
Him.
I love Jesus. Who said that?
You don't. You wouldn't insult him. Like that.
So when did I insult him? By reading your Bible, I insulted Jesus. Is that what you're saying?
You wouldn't keep picking flies with Jesus.
Are you saying by reading the Bible, I insulted Jesus?
No, you're picking flies.
Then you have a beef with your Bible, not me.
You're picking flies with Jesus.
Flies? What flies am I picking? It's the Bible I read.
By the way, you cannot understand the Bible.
Do I not? Explain that to me then. He put all his enemies under his feet. Explain that, please.
The natural man receives.
Explain what I just read there.
Listen to me.
Jesus put all his enemies under his feet.
Look at me while I'm talking.
I'm looking at you all this time.
Don't make demands, bro.
The natural man receives not the things of the Spirit of God.
Really?
Neither can he know them.
Why?
Because they are spiritually discerned.
Why?
You're on a carnal platform.
Okay, so you're not spiritually discerned. I'll tell you what. You're not spiritually discerned. How do you explain Jesus put all his enemies under his feet? Go on, explain that to me.
Ask Allah.
That is your Bible.
Wait till the end of time.
Why don't you ask Yahweh?
No, I'm not worried about it.
Ask Yahweh.
I'm not worried about it.
Because you can't explain it.
I don't have
You're spiritually discerned.
I don't have to explain
Exactly
it.
My point. Okay, anyway, shall I read? Look, there are many places in the Bible where Jesus... Sorry?
Have you heard of Pavlova?
Pablo?
Pavlova.
No, who's that?
Well, of course you wouldn't. You don't like dancing or anything like that. Pavlova was one of the greatest ballet dancers of all time.
Really?
She said, is not listening, if I could explain one of my dances, I couldn't do it.
Right. And what are you trying to say by that?
I'm saying there are things beyond explanation.
Really? So you're saying...
Have you heard of this?
So you're saying you cannot explain what I read in the Bible. Is that what you're trying to say?
Yeah.
So you're saying God actually gave you a book, but you don't understand it. Are you spiritually discerned,
sometimes,
like you claimed I was?
Just a minute. Sometimes I'm paddling. Sometimes the water goes up to my knees.
Yeah.
Later on, I'm here.
Right.
We're all searching and looking.
Fair enough.
Have you heard of the spin wheel?
Where is the water right now?
Just a minute.
Everything but Jesus,
you don't discuss
everything
the Bible. Yes.
My feet. Have you heard of the spin wheel?
Yes, I have.
What is it?
It's where you basically spin cotton. Is that right?
now.
Yeah, you make a thread out of cotton, the spin wheel.
The spin wheel takes place at the trooping of the colour.
Oh, that's a different spin wheel. Okay, carry on. Yeah.
And all the regiments move around in the square. There's no document, there's no history, no write-up how to do it. It just happens. There are things beyond our mind. There are things that we cannot understand.
Okay.
The spin wheel takes place on the trooping of the colour and nobody can put it into words.
Well, anyway, that's a good analogy. You know what? That actually fits with this. Because I'll tell you what, when God says in the Bible, he's not the author of confusion. And the fact that you do not understand this verse, it shows that this verse is not from God then. Because you seem to be confused. You said, I don't understand it. Which one is it now? Is he the author of confusion or is he not?
I've told you, sometimes I'm paddling,
yeah.
Sometimes needy, sometimes up to wait.
But what do you understand by when God says he's not the author of confusion?
Author of confusion?
Yes.
Is he or is he not? I'm not confused.
Then you understand the verse then?
No, I don't have to.
There you go, then you're confused.
I'm not.
Yes, you are.
Confused.
Because if you do not understand something...
I don't know.
I'll tell you what. What is the point of God giving you a guidance that you do not understand?
Because we're searching, we might find it tomorrow.
So have you,
or the day after.
So have you actually read it? Which part? Is it the English you don't understand? Or is it the message of God in English which you read in the Bible you don't understand?
This man is trying to use textbook, proof text, mathematics,
Bible,
understanding.
Bible, you didn't forget that bit.
Understanding, logic.
Yes.
Logic is not everything.
You got some.
Explain the offside rule to me without.
Hold on. Let's not get sidetracked.
No.
What we are talking about. Yes, you are.
No,
because I'm asking you. You said the Bible and Jesus is all about love. When I showed you about Jesus killing his enemies, you didn't like that bit. Why? Why would Jesus love his enemies and then kill them at the end?
Why makes
no sense.
Why is this man insulting their prophet?
I'm not. I'm telling you what the Bible says.
Insulting his
prophet. Every time I read the verse in the Bible, he's saying that's insulting Jesus.
It's insulting.
Now, is that my fault? Or is that what the Bible authors wrote? How is that my fault?
It's the Bible. It's
should I? Okay, I'll tell you what. Should I ignore those verses where he says Jesus kills?
Yeah, don't worry
kills.
About it. There are more important things.
Oh, so you don't... Wow. Do you think those verses are from God?
Yes, but I don't understand them fully.
So which part of Jesus killing his enemies you don't understand?
I don't understand it fully.
Okay, so you do not accept the fact that Jesus can love his enemy, but at the same time kill them.
Yeah.
Actually, I agree with you, because that's contradictory.
No, it isn't.
You're right, actually. You know what? This is what the difference between the Quran and the Bible is. The Quran, Allah says, if any book... Okay, if this book has a contradiction, yes, surely it's not from Allah. Surely it's not from Allah.
Okay.
I paraphrased it, but this is what it is. You see, the Bible, according to this gentleman here, is contradictory. In one passage, Jesus says, Let me finish.
You just said that he shouldn't read the Bible.
It says here that Jesus loves his enemies, but at the end, Jesus is going to kill them all. Okay? So you either love them or you kill them. Because the word love and the word kill are not synonymous.
Right.
All right? They are basically antonyms, and this is what the contradiction we see in the Bible. Because God has obviously created the hellfire for a reason. It says that in the Bible, there's a lake of fire where these sinners are going to be put in. If God loves them, why does he not put sin in there? Why does he put the sinners in there? Because this gentleman says, love the sinners, but not the sin. But guess what? You know what? God is going to put the sinners with the sin in the lake of fire. In the hellfire. And this is another bit which this gentleman doesn't want to hear.
How many sides?
It depends how much you're paying him.
Okay, now you want to talk about the Bible, I'll talk with you, because this is getting pointless, to be honest.
I'm asking your question about contradiction. How many sides on the coin?
Two sides.
Two sides?
Yeah.
Yeah, but they're different.
Yeah, they are different. Who said they're same?
They're different.
Did I say they're same?
They contradict each other.
Yeah, so?
They contradict each other.
So what's the point?
You can't handle contradictions. Earlier on,
I said, if God gives you a book and it has contradictory messages, then it'll be like you who's confused, who will say that I don't like that verse. I don't want you to read that verse. I want you to ignore that verse. You know why? Because it goes against his fitrah. His fitrah is saying this cannot be from God, who said, I love everyone, I love the enemies, and at the end, he kills all of them.
He believes things that he likes. That you like, don't you?
I believe in things. Wait. I believe in things. If God has written something in my Quran, I take it fully. Not like you pick and choose. You're cherry picking.
You're cherry picking there.
Didn't you tell me to ignore those verses?
You've never shut up about
Wait a minute, did you not tell me to ignore those verses which you didn't like?
You've never shut up about it.
About what?
It's not going to work, mate. You don't really care if you say that.
The natural man, he's a natural man. He doesn't receive the things of the Spirit.
You got something against natural people?
You're reading them with a carnal mind.
Ah, which mind do you read them with? Spiritual mind?
Spiritual mind. I'm paddling, but I'm going in the water.
But you told me to ignore those verses which you didn't like. You're cherry picking.
If you don't like them, ignore them.
Exactly my point. You're cherry picking.
That's definition.
Yes.
You see how you all gather around in packs.
No, this is called Speakerscorner.
How you all gather around the Muslims in packs.
Yes, I'm proud of
that. This is where you're going to fall
to. By the way, sorry, my book wasn't too...
Should be looked at with logic.
Brothers and sisters, Allahu Akbar, thanks to your tremendous support, we have, alhamdulillah, paid the final installment for this huge masjid property. And now we need your support to convert this 2,700 square meters building into the most amazing Islamic center in the country of Norway, inshallah.
But bro, this does not look like a masjid. It looks like a wedding hall.
And that's exactly what this is. Brothers and sisters, we need your support to reconstruct this wedding hall into a masjid and community center so we can have our prayer hall for us to establish salah 5 times a day. An indoor playground for the kids to nurture love for the house of Allah, a conference hall for lectures and reminders about Islam.
We need classrooms for education, a library to study, a gym for exercise, and a soup kitchen to help the poor and needy.
If you support us, even with a small sadaqah, you will inshallah harvest a reward for all of these facilities and the khair that they generate throughout the years, all the way until the day we meet Allah.
The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, whoever builds a masjid for the sake of Allah, Allah will build for him a similar house in Jannah. So what are you waiting for? Click the button to donate and share the video for extra rewards.